Well, welcome, and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family. Let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you.
It says in verse 1 of Matthew chapter 3, in those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea. The areas that would be most common and likely to find others to preach to would, of course, be watering holes. And as the Jordan runs down the Jordan Valley, near Jericho, in fact, this is where John the Baptist began to preach. And because people came to the Jordan for fresh water, not only from the side of the Transjordan, the country of Jordan, as we call it today, but also, as we discover here, from Judea and Jerusalem, many, many people were coming because they had heard that there was this Essene, this priest, as it were, who was speaking of the coming of the Messiah. Well, the content of his preaching was in verse 2, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Verse 3 and 4 tell us more about John. 5 and 6 then tell us, of course, what happened when he baptized him. Let's read verses 3 through 6. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Now John himself was clothed in camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Just a quick word about locust, the word locust there. Of course, it's springing out of the Hebrew for locust. And there's a very interesting discussion today about John in the wilderness of Judea and the availability of locusts to eat. Highly unlikely. As you saw the picture of Judean wilderness, locusts don't live off of dirt, okay? They don't eat rocks. They eat vegetation. Extremely little vegetation. And locusts are very seasonal. But there's a possibility that there was a copyist error between the Hebrew word for locust and the Hebrew word for carob, which is a good source of protein, very tasty thing, and is very prolific in the Judean desert, growing on the bushes, certainly not only by the Jordan River, but everywhere. And you could live off of them. Nonetheless, John was living in a very meager lifestyle, wearing a coat of fur in extremely, I mean, I've been in the Dead Sea. I've been at the Dead Sea in January, 102 degrees. That area has a capability of truly astonishing you with a great difference of temperatures between night and day. It's not without reason to be below freezing at night and over 100 degrees during the day. And that's a tremendous change that can really wreak havoc in the body. Well, this is John the Baptist. He was eating locusts and wild honey. And then Jerusalem, all Judea, and all the region, verse 5, around the Jordan, went out to him and were baptized by him in the Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, this is exactly what baptism is all about. But I want you to note here this morning that the word baptism speaks of something that is essential in all of our lives and was important for them as well in those days. We'll talk about now the difference between John's baptism and the baptism that would come after Christ's victory at the cross and over the grave. Well, repentance, of course, as we see in verse 2, the message, and now the results of that message in verse 6, confessing their sins. Repentance requires confession. It's not just an intellectual decision within your heart, well, I guess I'll stop doing that. If it's really bugging the Holy Spirit, it's not bugging me that much. But if it's bugging the Holy Spirit, or it's bugging my wife, or it's bugging the church, or it's bugging my neighbors or my boss, then maybe I'll just kind of cool it off for a while. And you know, that's not repentance. Okay, metanoeo means that you're thinking about it and you've made a complete change of mind concerning that action or that thought or what's happened, that sin. And it requires confessing that sin before God as well. Repentance is not repentance unless you confess it before God. By the way, it may even require your confession before others that you've harmed. And I just want to say to you, it's no more easy for me than it is for you. It's just not easy. Our flesh doesn't want to admit that we're wrong. You know, we don't want to place ourselves in a vulnerable position to others and say, you know what, I need you to forgive me. Would you please forgive me? That's vulnerability. You are now asking for them to respond to what you've done and your request for forgiveness. It's a place of humility. It's a place of contrition. It's a place, really, of vulnerability and saying, listen, I'm waiting. I need for you to respond to my question and forgive me. And many have suggested, and I love the fact that Jack Hayford has said that it's the most powerful thing that Christians can do is to forgive someone. Forgiveness releases us from indebtedness, not only to God, but also to others as well. And it pains me to hear from people who have said that they've been carrying around unforgiveness or bitterness for a day or 20 years. It just pains me because there's a liberty that isn't being enjoyed by them. There's a confine. There's a chain, a burden, a binding in their lives that they so need to be released from. And oh, how the Holy Spirit so wants to, as it were, kind of engage you and whatever person was involved with that and just be released by them. Oh, friend, I can tell you, forgiving someone is the most powerful thing you can do for them. It truly is. And confession is such an important part of that. Well, there are several baptisms in scriptures that the Bible talks about. In fact, it's interesting that in Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, there are six doctrines that Paul, I believe, who is the writer of Hebrews, talks about is important for the church to have a discussion on. And maybe someday we'll have this discussion again. But this is what he says in Hebrews 6, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, leaving the discussion of the basic doctrines of God, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms. Now, in your Bible, it is almost wholesalely true that your Bible has placed that word baptism in the plural. And that's because there were several baptisms and are several baptisms discussed in Scripture. And first of all, this morning in Matthew 3, we're talking about the baptism of John. Not necessary for Christians, but that was in fact a doctrine, a baptism in those days that was even dealt with later on in the book of Acts. However, there are other baptisms that I believe Scripture describes. First of all, there is that baptism that occurs at the moment we receive Jesus Christ as our Savior. And that is a baptism into the body of Christ. We are wholesalely, completely drenched, as it were, by the blood of Jesus and engaged now no longer in a commerce or in a citizenship of the world or of the flesh, of the devil. We are now citizens of the kingdom of God. We have been translated. We have been changed, metamorphosed. We are a new man, a new person with a new citizenship. Our passport, as it were, in eternity is engaged through the kingdom of heaven, not through the kingdom of man or the kingdom of earth. When you received Jesus Christ as your Savior, you were baptized into the body of Christ. And that, as it were, is essential to eternity with Jesus. Essential. You cannot be with Jesus for eternity without being baptized into his body. Secondly, there's a baptism of confession that we just saw in the sixth verse. And this baptism of confession is otherwise referred to as water baptism. It means you're being baptized because you've considered, you thought after, metanoeo, what you have done, you've confessed your sins, and you're ready to signify the confession before God through a baptism in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's water baptism. And you are saying to the world, listen, I'm a new creature. I'm a new person. I'm no longer compelled by the things of the past. I'm compelled by the Word and the Spirit of God. And I know many, if not most of you this morning have done that some point in your life. And I tell you, when the devil tries to describe you as not a Christian, all you got to do is point to your baptismal certificate and say, you know what, here's proof that I confessed Jesus as my Savior and others witnessed that I am no longer me. I'm a new creature in Jesus. Thirdly, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And this is, of course, something that Jesus actually personally describes in Acts chapter 2, verses 38 and 39. And Jesus, Peter in his sermon, he says, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of the Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's not the verse I was looking for. I'm looking for Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, where Jesus said, having assembled his disciples together, he said, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So three baptisms in Scripture. Some have suggested the baptism of suffering that Peter goes so far to speak about in his epistle is another baptism. I'll give in to that, but there are three important baptisms necessary in every person's life. And that, of course, would be the baptism into the body of Christ, baptism of confession, and baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, the interesting thing is that John's baptism was purely a baptism of repentance, but it didn't complete the thought. And I'll put it this way. It's possible for worldly people to actually repent, to think after what they've done. And you see, I mean, I used to be engaged in prison ministry for a number of years over in the Central Valley in Chowchilla Women's Prison and Corcoran Men's Prison. I was there several days, the entire day, every week. And the jailhouse confessions are interesting because oftentimes it's a result of what they've been caught doing rather than an issue of actually thinking about what they did. And now I really am feeling repentant about that. But you see, feeling bad about what you've done is not the entire equation. And that's exactly what John is providing here. He's providing a method for people to reconsider every day, you know what, I need to repent, I need to confess. But that doesn't, and John wasn't capable, and of course John's life was cut short before Jesus had his victory upon the cross and the grave. So the remainder of the equation was left out of John's baptism, and we discover actually later in the book of Acts that there were several people who understood the baptism of John but hadn't quite received the baptism of Jesus Christ or even the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So they were not yet baptized in the body of Christ because they knew not about Christ's victory at the cross and the grave. Cornelius was an example of that. Apollos was another example of that. Priscilla and Aquila. These are people in the gospel of the book of Acts that understood the baptism of repentance, but did not understand the baptism of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, which is so important for us and such a great blessing for us today. Some have suggested that salvation is only possible because of baptism. You may have heard that. And there are Christian churches that suggest to every one of us today that unless you get water baptized, you're not actually saved. And they misuse, as it were, the scripture I'm about to present to you in Acts chapter 2, verses 38 and 39. Peter's preaching here, and this is what he says: repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Now, that's interesting. Look at that up on the screen. For the remission of sins. You might suggest that, well, that's exactly what it's saying here. But of course, we know the word for can be used in two contexts, can't it? First of all, if you saw a poster in the old times and it said, Paul Berry wanted for robbery, would it be a classified ad asking, will Paul Berry please come and do some robbery? And that's what the word for could suggest. Wouldn't you agree? Would Paul Berry please come and finally do some robbery? Well, Paul Berry wanted for robbery. There's a job that they're looking for Paul Berry to do. Or is it because of Paul Berry wanted because of robbery? Some would suggest that it is in order of, in other words, the word being used by Peter, unfortunately, in the English translation, suggests that we're being baptized for the purpose of our sins being remitted, rather than because of our sins being remitted. And of course, this is what Christian doctrine tells us, that we get baptized because our sins have been remitted, not for or in order for our sins to be remitted. Understand that? Everybody okay with that? You see the distinction there? It's an important one because, if someone says to you, well, have you been baptized yet in water? And no, I haven't. Well, you're not saved. Really? Can you tell me why? Well, this is the scripture right here, and you can tell them. Well, it doesn't mean in order for. It means because of. That's just what the word for means here. And praise God, all of us should have the interest in our lives. If your sins have been remitted by the blood of Jesus, that you get baptized because of that. And that's the joy of coming together with people who are being baptized in water, and they're celebrating that their sins have been taken away. They've been paid for. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to the baptism, he said to them, brood of vipers, who warned you to flee the wrath to come? Therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance. Isn't it interesting that repentance bears fruit? You can see people that have repentant hearts, because they have engaged their lives in stopping doing what they've done. Wouldn't it be wonderful if you told your child, please, I don't want you to do that anymore. And then they lived a life from that moment on, bearing the fruit of deciding not to do that. But that's exactly what the Lord, our Father, is desiring from you. He wants you to decide that I see this sin just like you see it, God, as evil and horrible and stinky and repulsive, and I don't want to do it again. And by me not doing that, it bears the fruit of righteousness. It bears the fruit of repentance, and it becomes obvious in a person's life. It really does. And it was obvious in the Pharisees and Sadducees, I don't think just because they wore, but rather what they wore, but rather the countenance of them. And isn't it interesting? And I've never heard this from any pastor at a baptism, that he would turn to somebody there on the beach or at the pool and say, you viper. You brood of vipers. Get out of here. Come back when you have the fruit of repentance. Now, I've never said that at a baptism. I've wanted to say it a number of times to other people. But you see, repentance bears fruit. It really does. 2 Corinthians 7, 9 through 11. Look at that. Write it down. We've run out of time. I want you to write that down. Look at it later, because it shows you the fruit of repentance. 2 Corinthians 7, verses 9 through 11. 9 through 11. Jesus says, well, don't think for a second that you can say, well, we have Abraham as our father, therefore we're on the inside. We're on the in crowd. Doesn't matter. Jesus says, John says, listen, God could bring up relatives of Abraham from the rocks if he wanted to. So, listen. The Lord is bringing, as it were in John's day, and as it were today as well, an axe to the root of the tree. There is no more time for the church to dictate human beings' lives. There is an essential need for the Word and the Spirit of God to dictate humans' lives. And I just, if the Church of Jesus Christ would get into God's Word, we wouldn't have a lot of the social ills that we have today. It's clear that the majority of the people of California do not want their children to be taught about, transgender issues. They don't want that. But you see, the legislature, in the absence of a voice from the Christians, do what they think you really want or what they think is better for you than what you think is better for you. Listen, if the Word of God and the Spirit of God are important to us, let's bring an axe to the root of the stupidity that is invading humankind today. That's what John said. It's time for what has been established to be cut down because it's not bearing the fruit that we all want. Now, I'm not talking about, social rebellion, though it may come to that someday. But it's time for us to write our congressmen. It's time for us to stand up and say, enough is enough. Enough is enough. For his winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he shall burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. There's no warm and fuzzy future for those who refuse to repent. There's no keg party with the Swedish bikini team waiting for those in Hades. It's truly eternal torment. And it is amazing. I'm amazed at this myself, that God provided me the means by which to change my eternity simply by repenting and receiving Jesus Christ as my Savior. It's astonishing. And I'm in awe of the fact that that same provision is for you this very morning. Let's just close our eyes and bow our heads for a moment. Because I just can't conclude. I know we're late. We're 5 minutes afterwards. Single overtime, right? But what about the opportunity to consider right now your account of wrongdoing before God? And taking care of that right now by a simple conversation with the Lord of all glory. Here's the conversation. Just repeat it after me. And if you do, with sincerity, you will be changed for eternity. Here's the prayer. Father in heaven, I give my heart to you. I give you my mind. I give you my soul. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come and wash me of my sins. Come and cleanse me from my wrongdoing with the power of your blood. Oh, that precious blood. Wash me, Jesus. I ask you, Jesus, put your Holy Spirit in me now that will give me the power to resist the ways of the world, the ways of the devil. Because I want to do what's right from this point on. I need a lasting change. I need a new life. That can only start with a new heart. Please, make me a new creature. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer this morning, you've been baptized in the body of Jesus Christ. There's not a single hair on your head that isn't saved at this moment. There's nothing on you, in you, around you, or anything about you that isn't wholly and completely the possession of Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit. This new life is precious before God, and He wants you to be careful as you grow it up before Him now. Get into the Bible. Get into the Word of God. come and join us as we engage ourselves in this journey with Jesus together. And when the trumpet sounds, you will be called to heaven into His presence. And there you'll be forever. If you didn't pray that prayer this morning, be careful never to mock the name of Jesus. Be careful never to think in terms of a waste of time. Listen, life is a waste of time without Jesus. I want you to know that.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this Word and in His Spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.